When you're sad and blue and everything is putting you down, you know the world keeps spinning around. You know you're not alone.
Yes, with MS, the world keeps spinning around, but you're not alone. Welcome to the 10 Minutes for MS podcast, in which we share information about MS in just 10 minutes.
In this episode, I'm glad to welcome Dr. Megan, a psychologist, neuropsychology, and trauma specialist.
Welcome, Dr. Megan, to our show 10 Minutes for MS podcast.
Thank you so much for having me.
Doctor, chronic illness really brings in along a lot of anxiety. As we know, it is not just a physical disability, it can also lead to a mental disability. So that's why we needed to have you on a show helping us to deal with the anxiety and the fear that the chronic illness brings along with it. So thank you once again for joining us here. And I'm going to ask you my first question, which is, what do you think, what are the psychological impacts of a chronic disease?
Yeah, I think that this is a great question, actually, because I think that we often don't think about that. I suppose in the general public, people don't think that having a physical illness can lead to having psychological effects, but it definitely does. I think the main things that we think about with MS is that those with the diagnosis are more at risk for developing things like anxiety and depression. That's not to say that that would definitely be the case, but it's just really important to be aware that having the symptoms of MS, things like fatigue, having, you know, lots of potentially kind of dizziness and so it's sort of wide ranging symptoms can mean that that takes its toll. You know, also you can have fatigue, certain levels of pain and discomfort, and that can make our mood dip, which would be pretty natural. But also if you're dealing with that on a day to day basis, and other issues, you know, maybe sleep problems, things like that can make us more, all of us more prone to developing like an anxiety or a depression type illness. So I guess just simply having the diagnosis means we're you may be more at risk, but there are certainly things you can do to boost your mood and to manage those more emotional aspects, which would hopefully help with some of the physical ones too.
All right. So, Doctor, what are the best ways that you can suggest is to improve our mental well-being? Are there any lifestyle changes or treatments that one can go for?
Yes, I would say whenever we think about mental health, I always go to the physical aspect first. So, you know, thinking about our basics that make up our health. So are we kind of getting enough sleep? Are we taking in a little bit of exercise? Are we breathing enough? Are we drinking enough water? Are we eating healthily? All of those things, because actually those are the building blocks that then affects how we think about the world and ourselves and how we feel emotionally. So if you are struggling emotionally, I would check out all of those things and do a bit of what I call a well-being check, to go through a little list of all those areas covered, because if one of them isn't or a few of them aren't, that may be what's impacting our mood and our emotions, as well as on top of that, obviously managing all of the symptoms and the lifestyle changes and adjustments that having MS comes with. So I would say at a basic level, checking out those few things and making sure if you can try and make improvements in those areas, that will be really important. And then in terms of managing our emotions, I think the first thing is to allow them to be there, you know, and this will depend a lot on what stage you're at in terms of diagnosis. If you've just found out that you've got MS, if it's something that you've been dealing with for a long time, but the symptoms are getting worse, all of those things are going to impact on how we think and feel about ourselves and what our mood is like. So I think acknowledging and allowing whatever your thoughts and feelings are about your illness, you know, that you're going to have ups and downs with it, and you're going to have times where it feels a bit easier and times where it feels really, really challenging. So just that idea of kind of being kind to ourselves is really important. and just trying to make sure our thoughts aren't a place where we kind of attack ourselves, that it's a place where we reassure and we help ourselves feel safe. And that can be really difficult when we're dealing with difficult symptoms. But I would say making sure that we're not turning our thoughts on ourselves as much as possible, and doing things that make us feel good. You know, if exercise was something that you loved but can't do as much of, making sure you still do a little bit in whatever way, making sure you're still seeing your friends, you're still connecting with people, being part of a community like your Instagram is and your podcast is, it's really important to have that support around you. So it's kind of thinking about lots of different areas of your life are going to kind of impact on our mood.
So it's like you should love yourself and do everything that you love so that you feel happy and positive. Yeah,
definitely. And do what makes you you. I think one of the things that people talk to me about often is the shift in how you see yourself when you've been diagnosed. So you may see yourself as not quite yourself, or yourself but with this huge stressor. And that's going to be really natural to think that way. But I think it's also important to know that you're still you and doing things that make you feel like yourself, even if they're much smaller now because of your symptoms. But that's going to be really important.
Right, definitely. You know, this is advice we always give to MS patients, that, you know, be yourself. Don't think that's a new you. Maybe you can be a stronger you, but don't be a weaker person from what you were earlier. You know, you have to be stronger than before, and don't lose your identity. It doesn't define you. What do you think, what role does positivity can play, you know, in a person's life who has just been diagnosed with MS? How can he cope with the new diagnosis?
I think giving yourself a bit of time and space to adjust to what's happened, you know, not expecting yourself to be positive straight away is really important. You know, allowing yourself to go through that process, because you know, you have had a big life change. And with any change, whether it's good or bad, there are things that are gained and there are things that are lost. And it's really important to just acknowledge that life is going to be different. It's not necessarily going to be better or worse. It's just going to be different. And giving yourself that time is sort of the first thing. And then I would say, you know, all of the things that help you to feel better, you know, maybe before you were diagnosed, things that lifted your mood or made you feel more connected to other people or to the world around you, are going to be much more important. So I almost imagine it as kind of take your self-care that you would do normally. Hopefully you would do some. Some people, you know, we all struggle with that, and sometimes we're not great at self-care, but taking those bits that you would have done before and almost doubling it, because you actually need so much more self-care when you're going through the process of receiving a diagnosis and you're thinking about what your life's going to be like. It's an emotional process. So it's going to be really important that you do even more of the things that made you feel good before.
Wonderful. Actually, you know, you have to make yourself comfortable in your body along with the diagnosis. So give yourself time and peace. When you really need to cry initially, just cry and let your emotions burst out. Don't hide the inside so that you don't get depressed. So what do you think, if someone keeps the emotions inside, does that lead to depression for a person?
Yeah, it can do. It can do. And I think, you know, when we've had something like a diagnosis or a big adjustment, it can be really natural to want to withdraw and not speak to people and not do things that you used to do. And actually, those are the things that make you at more at risk of getting something like depression. There might be a period of time where you need to do that. As you said, you need to cry, or you need to be alone, or you need to withdraw. And that's absolutely fine. But it's about making sure that you are still also, you know, once you've had that bit of time to do that, that you're then doing things that do make you feel better, and making sure that you are, you know, adapting some of the things that you used to do. So as I said, if it was sort of like exercise that you used to do a lot of, still being able to do, you know, the 5 or 10 minutes a day, or even just going for a walk, or even just sitting outside, you know, making sure that you're still getting a little bit of that enjoyment, even if the activity looks quite different to how it used to. And I think the way to then move on from that kind of grieving process and that adjustment process to feeling more positive is just making sure that you are focused on the things that you can do, even if they're smaller versions, you know, and celebrating your successes and celebrating those days where you have had a little bit more energy, or you have been able to still see friends or still, you know, speak on the phone to people or whatever it is that you're wanting to do. It's really important to still have a focus where you set yourself goals and then celebrate those goals. That's going to keep you motivated and keep you feeling like you're coping and keeping your mood lifted.
Absolutely. So go on and be strong, celebrate, be happy, be positive and get stronger than before. Yes.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Thank you so much, Doctor, for your wonderful advices today. It was a pleasure having you here. And I hope everybody listening to your advices today will actually follow it and can relate to whatever you said today. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for having me. It's been a real pleasure to speak with you today.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Warriors, for being with us. I hope you found this session useful. We will be back again next week with another informative session. So, don't forget to subscribe and reserve just 10 minutes for MS.
No, you're not alone.